1997. For the Heritage Series of Local 600, we're here today with the distinguished cinematographer, Mr. VILMOS ZSIGMOND, ASC. Hello, VILMOS. How are you?
Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to be here.
Well, thank you for being part of our Heritage Series. We think it's a very important series. It's been a lot of fun doing it, and so the people who have seen it really like it.
It was a lot of fun for me also to see some of these series, and I really enjoyed, you know, watching those 2 hours of a lot of cameramen, and I learned a lot from them.
Oh, thank you. That pleases me a lot to hear that. What we usually start off with is a little bit of personal history, VILMOS. Where are you from?
I was born in Hungary, and I was educated in Hungary, and when I was 26 years old, that's when the Hungarian Revolution started, and I left the country at that time.
Well, before we talk about you leaving the country, you were educated as a filmmaker, as a photographer?
Well, I was not really educated as a filmmaker. In fact, you know, I had a hard time to get an education at all because, as we know, in Hungary in those days, you know, after the Second World War,
very
World
difficult.
War in 1945, you know, we had a couple good years of a sort of free democracy, but then the communists took over the country, and since I came from a sort of bourgeois family, mm-hmm. I mean, quote unquote bourgeois, I mean, mm-hmm. you know, my father was a soccer coach and
middle class
actually, but in a communism that is called bourgeois, mm-hmm. you know, middle class is you know whatever they like, whoever they like to have that is the workers and the peasants, because they wanted actually strengthen communism actually by relying on the masses, and then mostly Hungary was a peasant country and a workers country. So as coming from a bourgeois family, I had a hard time actually to get to university. My father wanted me to become an engineer, and originally I wanted to apply to go to university and become an electronic engineer. But they would not take me. They came up with all kind of answers. You know, they didn't tell me the truth that I was a bourgeois family member, so I cannot go to actually university. So I had a problem to find out what I'm going to do with my life. And at that time, actually, I was a good table tennis player.
Mm.
And
ping pong.
Ping pong, yeah. And I was very good, actually. I actually won the championship in my city, actually,
really?
At one time. And I didn't even know that time that that's going to lead me to become a cameraman, you know, because it's so far away, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Sports and arts, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not really close together,
not
you
even
know.
Close.
And so what happened, I became a worker actually in a textile factory. And I was playing ping pong for the team. And they started to like me, you know, and they forgot about my bourgeois you know, family thing. And even the party chief came to me and said, listen, I don't understand. I mean, don't you want to go to university? Don't you want to, you know, become somebody, you know? I said, listen, I cannot go ahead because, you know, they cut my way always. So I said, well, let's see what we can do, you know? And then we sat down and I said, listen, first of all, you have to cut your correspondence with your father, my father at that time lived in Morocco, French mm-hmm. Morocco, mm-hmm. Casablanca. Mm-hmm. And I was corresponding with him, you know, as a son, you know? And I said, listen, while you are corresponding with your father, they will think that you are a spy.
Oh,
you are
no.
a spy. You are an enemy of the state. So why did you just stop corresponding with him? You know. So well, it's going to be a hard thing for me to do because, after all, he's my father. I mean, he loves me and I love him.
Yeah.
So, all right, I'm going to try to do it. And what else? He said, well, you have to prove yourself. You have to do something, you know, which the Communist Party is going to think that you are a good guy. So I was thinking, what can I do? And by that time, I was a still photographer, basically. I started taking pictures early. Maybe I was 14 years old, 15 years old. My father had a little Kodak camera. And I was pretty good at it as a kid. And then at one time, I mean, I'm talking about, you know, how actually chance and luck actually shapes sometimes your future, you
it's
know.
It's important to know.
When I was 17 years old, I was very sick. I was in bed for 3 months.
What
I could not go
have?
To school. I had a sort of kidney
disease. A kidney infection.
Mm-hmm. infection. And I had an uncle who was a great amateur photographer. Mm-hmm. Like, give me a book. He gave me a book to read. And it was one of Hungary's greatest photographer, Eugene Dulovich, who had a book which he described for that, he described his passion about photography. And he said, I am a lover of photography. And I'm a lover of light. And that whole book was about light, beautiful backlit subjects, people, gorgeous lighting and all that. So I really fell in love with photography at that time.
And that's what inspired you.
And that's what inspired me to take pictures. Mm-hmm. I mean, I became a sort of amateur photographer. I bought up my developing kit and a larger, and I was doing, you know, my pictures at home. So now when I'm at the textile factory, I said, oh yeah, I see. I said, yeah, well, yeah, I think I can do something. I can start a photo club in the factory. And nobody at that time actually was teaching workers mm-hmm. for photography. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, photography was an elite mm-hmm. kind of a, mm-hmm. a thing, you know. So I said, I will start a photo club. We will buy a camera, we will buy developing machines and enlargers and all that. I'm going to teach photography. They fell for that. I said, that's a wonderful idea, you know. So within 3 years, I became a hero. I was, you know, they put my picture on the wall at the dark room, and I became, you know, a good guy. And then a year later, they came to me and said, listen, I think, you know, there's a cinema school in Budapest. There's a university, a college for cinematography. Are you interested to go there? Sure, I'm interested in. I didn't know what it was. I really didn't know how movies were made. I was sort of pretty dumb about cinematography in those days. Because I didn't know. I knew about amateur photography. I saw movies, but it never really interested me that how a movie is being done. You know, I didn't know how close it was to photography, basically. And they said, well, I said, why don't you try it? So I know that, I remember now that it was very difficult to get into that school, because that year when I applied to go to the film school in Hungary, there were about 1,000 applicants. Mm. And they could only take maybe 20. Ooh. So I had to go through examinations after examinations, first in my city. But luckily, I showed some of my stills, mm-hmm. which they liked, and then that always kept me going into the next group and the next group, and finally I got to the final group, which meant a 3 days very serious examination in Budapest, you know, where they took us into museums and to see movies, and we had to critic the movies.
Wow.
And that was also a very funny situation, because in those days they showed us a lot of bad Russian movies. That those terrible social realist movies,
yes.
which were horrible. And you know, they took us into a movie, and I remember the title was The Miners of Donetsk. It was about the life of the miners. And it was the worst movie I ever seen in my life. And we were together, about, you know, all 20 of us, we were watching this movie, and then we knew that we had to write a criticism about this movie. And you know, being Hungary, being a satellite of the Russians in those days, we were afraid to actually tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, the film was so bad that we said, if you don't tell the truth, maybe they won't even accept you to school, because they would think that we don't know. But
can't
a good movie.
Yes, yes.
So we decided we will tell them the truth. And we were lucky by choosing that, because, you know, that partly actually helped us, you know, to get accepted to the
film
school.
That was the test, to find out if you knew the difference.
It was, basically, yeah.
Very good.
And so then, you know, I went to the film school for 40 years.
What was the name of the film school?
Well, it was basically the Hungarian State University mm-hmm. of Film and Theater Arts.
Wonderful. So and this gave you, were they good teachers? Did you get a good background?
We had incredible teachers, actually. We had the best cinematographers teaching us. You know, we had to decide at that time right away, when we applied, you know, for this university, we had to decide whether we are going to be cameramen or directors or production designers or whatever, you know, actors, and so on. So that was all departmentalized, you know. So I decided, of course, you know, to be a cinematographer. And you know, my teachers were the best. They were the best, I would say, not only in Hungary, but Hungary always had a good film background from the very beginning. I remember, you know, I was reading about the beginning of the Hungarian the filming. They were right there the very first year, when the first movie camera was invented, you know, in Hungary in that year, already they were actually shooting movies. So Hungary was pretty much, in those days, they were very closely connected to Western Europe.
Well, and also Hungary had a history of an art background, and the royalty, at least, was always very aware of art and bringing it over, and so there was centuries of art history also in Hungary.
Also in the connections, you know, I mean, many of our students always went to Western universities, to London, to Paris, to Berlin. Mm-hmm. So Hungary always had great connections with the West.
So you learned quite a bit at school. It was helpful. Some people are hurt by their school, you know. It
was very helpful that our teachers were really the best cinematographers of those days.
So you finished school by about what year then? Would you have finished your
That
your
was in
training?
1955.
About 1955. And what did you do then?
Well, I actually was selected to go to the studio where they were making feature films.
Wonderful.
You know, some of us went to documentary films, some of us went to newsreel. They thought that I had the ability to become a feature film cameraman.
So they recognized your talent, actually.
They recognized my talent from my little films that I made. You know, every year we had to make a sort of a graduation film.
Student
and
films.
And the last film was a graduation film, which was like a 30-minute short, which was actually always projected in Hungarian theaters.
16 millimeter?
No, it was 35.
They worked on 35, excellent.
We worked on 35 because I think in those days, 16 millimeter was not really that good, you know. It was not good enough to show it in movie theaters.
So in Hungary at the time, they had film itself, or did you have to bring the film from Kodak? I mean, I don't know. Where did you get the film?
Actually, in those days, we had the film from Germany.
From Germany? So
and then sometimes, I think, from France. Gebert, I think it was French. Mm-hmm. Either French
yes.
or English.
Agva,
so we had Gebert and Agfa.
Okay. And
Hungary had some negative filmmaking facilities called Forte. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't really too good, so.
Well, but there was a certain amount of processing and things like that that you could do on there, as opposed to shipping it someplace, that's what I'm saying.
No, we had good processing laboratories and we had great technicians.
Mm-hmm. So you were able to take your film and work it there and cut it and edit it in 35 millimeter, because that's a terrific.
We had some editing teachers, you know, who were teaching us editing, mm-hmm. and they were cutting our movies, you know.
Wonderful.
Together with us, and then we had to put music under that. We had to mix sound, and so we had to go through all the phases of movie making. We didn't only learn to be a cinematographer, but we learned everything else. You know, production design, for example, and everything what a cinematographer has to know.
Well, how a scene fits together. You know, a beginning shot, internal shots, and then a way out to the next scene. It's very important.
And besides that since it was on a university level, we had other subjects, you know, we had the same subjects like we were studying becoming lawyers or doctors or, you know, we had to have the same subjects, you know, in arts and music and mm-hmm. so we got a pretty good overall education.
So then by 1956, were you working as a filmmaker in the studio system there?
I was working as an assistant cameraman first, and we needed experience. I mean, we had some experience during the school years, because every summertime we went and worked as trainees with our teachers mm-hmm. in big movies that they were shooting. So we gained some experience, but it's a different thing, you know, when you are observing somebody and when you are doing it yourself. And when you do it yourself, that's when you really learn a lot, because you make so many mistakes. And and you have to learn from your own mistakes.
And do they have the same system, like a film loader and a second assistant and a first assistant and a operator that we have here?
Well, we basically, you know, didn't have a film loader. The assistant cameraman had to do everything there, you know. So the assistant loaded the film and was focusing.
And so you're immediately loading film and pulling focus? So like a first assistant's job immediately?
Oh, yeah. But immediately we had to do that. And it was a difficult job, you know. I always said, you know, that the most difficult job in cinematography is to be an assistant cameraman. Mm-hmm. The most important, most technical, most incredible job is the assistant cameraman job. You know?
Oh, yeah. So by the big break that happened to you with the Hungarian Revolution, you were already working.
Well, you know, I was before that. I became an operator also, because the Hungarian system was not really a system where we had operators to operate the camera, because the DP used to operate the camera there also. But since we were students of our teachers, the teachers let us operate their cameras, you know.
Wonderful.
Because they wanted us to get experience in that.
So by the time you were finished school, by the time you were 24 or so, you had been an operator. And do you recall who you were an operator for, any particular cinematographer?
Oh, we had them all, you know. We had István Ájben, who was one of the greatest in Hungary, you know. And George Illés, who is still alive, actually, and I see him every year.
Yeah.
And he's we consider him the father of all cameramen, basically.
Really?
Well, I mean, he's so proud of all his students, you know, who came to America and to Canada and to Western Europe and all that. So we were working for these guys, you know, a lot.
Were there any other Americans who are known now as American cameramen who were you working with?
Well, you know, we were together with Laszlo Kovács. In fact, you know, when we get to that point, you know, when we will escape from Hungary in a few months after this, I escaped together with Laszlo Kovács.
Well, how did you meet him? Is you were both students together?
Well, we were students together, and he was a year under my class, and we became very good friends. I liked him very much. And while the revolution was happening in Budapest, we were actually shooting a documentary. Mm-hmm. All of us, you know, all cameramen who could get hold of a camera, and we were on the streets and documenting the historical events.
Well, it was a horrific thing. I mean, the Hungarian people rose up to try to throw off the communists, and they were expecting help from the Americans, and the Americans stayed away, and then the tanks came in. All that happened, right?
Well, you know, it was a beautiful thing, basically, because it was a moment in the history of Hungary where all people were together. When we have 100% of the people sticking together and demonstrate on the streets, and there were only a few percent of diehard communists, you know, who probably sold their souls, you know, and they could not make the change, and those were the ones, you know, who were shooting the people on the streets and killed people. And it was a terrible thing. But it was over, like, in a few hours. The people took the power. There was no question.
Boom.
The Russian tanks were burning on the streets. They could not do anything to us. In fact, the Russian soldiers who survived this thing, you know, they sided with us. They said that that's what we want also. I mean, we want freedom. We want exactly what you want, you know. Because they sensed, you know, what was happening in Hungary in 1956. And, you know, we controlled the country until the Russians came in November 4th.
It was a month or so?
No, it was like only probably 10 days.
10 days?
We had the 10 days of freedom. That's all what we had, you know. 10 days. And the Russians, in those days, they could not let Hungary become free, because they were actually scared of the domino effect of Czechoslovakia, Poland.
Everything else falling.
Yugoslavia. And they were so afraid that they had to come in and with the tanks and break the whole thing down. You know?
So you were being a documentary cameraman at the time when you took pictures of this?
Actually, I was a feature film cameraman at that time, but I became a documentary cameraman on the streets, like everybody else. You know, we had to do that for... And then when the Russians came in, we had all this footage, which we didn't know what to do with it.
It was
in
all
fact,
negative.
We were scared that the Russians are going to take it away, because everybody knew that we were, you know, photographing the events. so that we outsmarted the Russians actually, because we, every single time, you know, when we developed the film, we immediately made a do positive of it, and we put the original negatives on the shelves in the film studio. So when the Russians came in and they said, "Where is the film?" I said, "There it is, right on the shelves, you know." They were everything, all the negatives. They were the originals, so they could check it, and they knew that was the negative. They took it all away, you know. They took it back to Moscow, but we had the dupe positive hidden, and we made actually several dupe negatives after that, you know, copies of those, you know, which were given out to different people. So I was given actually a series
of these several
negatives because I volunteered actually to go to the West.
And how did that work? How did that happen?
We actually get about 10,000 feet of film.
10,000. You had 10,000 feet. 10 big film, cans.
10 big cans actually, which had to break down to smaller cans because we could not hide it. Mm-hmm. So we hit the small 400 feet rolls actually in the inside of a spare tire. We put them on in a spare tire. And we were actually going towards the border, you know, with that truck, with a good permit. We had a great permit, you know, to go to Austria. Uh-huh. But the day when we had to cross the border, they revoked all the permits. The Russians already controlled, actually, that time, the borders.
Yes.
So they revoked all the permits. We had to take all the film out from the tire and put it into potato sacks. And we started to walk towards the border with potato sacks and the film in it.
We
brought nothing, no clothing and nothing, you know, to bring. All there is the film. And, you know, Laszlo, that's when I ran into Laszlo in Budapest, you know, a couple of days before this happened, you know, when the Russians came in and roamed around the city, which was in ruins, and I still had my camera. I said, "Laszlo, come on, let's go shoot." "Shoot what?" He said, shoot the street, shoot the tank, shoot everything. So we shot for 3 days, you know, from all hidden sources, the ruins of the city and all that, you know, and that was not developed there. We had to take the original negative out to Austria.
So you snuck across the border. How did you get across?
It was very difficult to get across, but because the Russians already controlled the borders. There were patrols going back and forth. In fact, we ran into a patrol and they actually captured us.
Really?
And we had a film with us.
Oh, no.
And we knew that if they find the film on us, they would kill us.
Yeah.
They killed people in the street just taking stills. So it was starting to get dark. And we were in a cornfield and we decided with Laszlo that we are going to hide the film. And so I ran into a cornfield. Russians, meantime, you know, they have the machine guns on them, you know, and they thought that we want to run away from them. But I ran behind the corn stack and put the film inside. And when they was yelling to get out of there, I got out without the film. So they captured us. Laszlo was not close to a corn stack. So what I was yelling at Laszlo, I said, "Laszlo, just get rid of the film. Just drop it. I mean, your life is more important than the film, basically. That's why." So he just dropped behind the bush. And then the Russians were scared because we were about 15, 20 people around there, and they were only two guys. They were scared because they thought we had maybe guns or something like that. So they captured us and took us into the camp. And then, you know, we started to deal with them. Said, "Listen, we just leave here at the border. And what do you want from us? You know, we want to go back to our family and all that. You lied to them, you know." So we gave them our watches, rings, whatever we had, valuables in us, money. We gave them everything. They let us go. Then we had to go back to the cornfield to find the film.
It was the cornfield on the Austrian side?
No.
It was still in
Hungary.
Oh.
We had to go backward.
Because
the camp was near the border. So we had to go a couple of miles back in the middle of the night to find a cornfield. And one corn stack looks like the other corn stack.
Of course.
And you have hundreds of them, right? Yeah. And you try to find, you know, our footsteps or something, you know. Where were we? So we found Laszlo's film first, because that was easier, because that was behind the bush. But then we figured it out. If Laszlo was here, the Kuhn stack was there, so he found actually my stack of film also.
My goodness.
And then we started to run.
And then you got.
And then we started to run. We ran about, I would say, about 5 miles. We ran straight to the border because you know that the patrols went that way, and then now we have maybe a little time to.
Now was to the border through. Fence or was it?
No, it wasn't actually. In those days, it was a strange situation that between Hungary and Austria. Sort of friendship started to develop. Austria was a free country in those days. Hungary was still, of course, you know, a Russian satellite. But, you know, Austrians complained about the mines at the borders mm-hmm. And the dogs and, you know, there were a lot of people dying on the borders who wanted to escape. So Austria finally convinced the Hungarians that they should take away the mines and all that. So the border was quite open in those days. That's how 200,000 Hungarians actually left the country that time.
Got across.
200,000, can you believe it? Out of 10 million people, so 200,000. How many percent is that?
A large percent.
It's like, what, 5%?
At least.
5% of the country just walked out of the country. Yeah. Never went back.
So you get to Austria. You have 2 bags of film, no clothes, no money, no friends, no nothing, right? What did you do?
Well, we had the film.
You had the film?
Remember that? And we thought that, this film is very valuable, right? So we went to the lab first. We told them we have some film. Said, okay, we will develop it for you. And they said, develop it, they printed it. And they said, you know what, we even try to sell it for you. They called up NBC, ABC, CBS. They had all, you know, correspondents in Austria. And NBC paid us $100 just to see the film first. Before we show it to CBS or other. And when they looked at the film, I said, well, you know, we already have this film. That's what they said, but they already had actually all the film, but you see people being killed on the streets because all the news reporters did that. What they didn't have actually is the story of the revolution, what we shot.
Yes.
The people, how excited the people were, how the farmers brought food for the people in Budapest who were starving, and how the windows of shops had broken glass and nobody touched, you know, the merchandise. Nobody was stealing in those days, you know.
No looting, no vandalism.
No looting, no nothing, you know. And that was the story of the revolution, how pure, how beautiful it was.
Mm-hmm.
But NBC didn't see that. They turned us down. And so did CBS, so did ABC.
Oh, no.
So did everybody. We could not do anything with the film.
Oh, no.
And we had this hotel bill, you know, because we went into a hotel.
Of course.
And we thought, we are going to have a lot of money. We didn't have a penny here. So finally, we were lucky that the lab again helped us to find a German-Hungarian producer who already collected by then all the film about the Hungarian Revolution. And he wanted to make the story of the revolution. He bought the film from us.
Finally, you
found it. For very little money, basically.
But something.
It was something that we could pay the bills at the hotel and the laboratory. And we had probably $500 when we came to the United States, each of us.
So that's what you did. You took that money, and that's what you financed you to leave Austria.
Well, they didn't have to finance it, because actually they were all kind of organizations in those days, you know,
for
the refugees. You know, I mean, Austria was loaded with Hungarians, 200,000 Hungarians.
They want to get rid of them.
That's right, living in camps. I mean, they really wanted to find places for these people. And they were people around the world were very generous, actually, to accept us.
So you took a plane to?
Well, some of the people took a plane, you know. We took a ship.
You took a ship.
We took actually an army.
You and Laszlo are now a team.
And Laszlo, at that time we were separated,
uh-huh.
which is another story I don't want to tell you because it's another half an hour. It doesn't maybe belong to this interview, but that's a funny story anyhow. But we were separated, and we later on we found each other in Salzburg. And he actually waited a little bit longer because he could not decide where he wanted to go.
Mm-hmm.
my decision was made by my father, actually, who immediately flew over from Casablanca to meet me. And he said, because I didn't know where to go. I just wanted to go every place. You know, I was hungry to see the world. Mm-hmm. I wanted to go to Australia, to England, to France, everywhere.
Every place you had heard of and couldn't go.
And I didn't even want to go to America in those days because I said, I can go there basically in the future anytime, but Australia is too far. And my father said, no, you have to go to America. And he goes, his dream was always to go to America. Uh-huh. And he was a soccer coach, you know?
Yes, of course.
He was a great goalkeeper and a coach. And he always wanted to come to America and start soccer, you know? Mm-hmm. Which was nothing in those days.
Still, it's
today
just barely catching
on. It's getting on. Yeah. But he wanted to actually to come in and start it, but unfortunately that's another story that he could not live long enough to do that, you know? But he told me, you have to go to Hollywood. That's it.
That's it.
And I listened to him, actually.
So you went directly to Hollywood? You flew?
Well, not directly, actually, because I thought that I went directly to Hollywood, but I went directly to Camp Kilmer, actually, where we went in a camp and they were processing us. And again, they had to find people who will actually give us a start. Right?
Camp Kilmer is where?
Camp Kilmer is in New York,
in
actually.
New York, okay.
In the old days, Staten Island was the place where all the refugees went. But since we had so many people in those days, 30,000, they actually opened up Camp Kilmer for us, which was an army camp.
Uh-huh.
And that's where they kept us until they found place for everybody.
So how did it work for you?
Well, they put us on a train, and I thought that I'm going to go to Hollywood on the train, and I ended up in Chicago. Freezing cold.
Middle of winter.
January.
Oh.
Freezing to death with a very light jacket. And I said, what am I doing here? You know, and I realized, you know, that there was a family who adopted us actually for, and gave us a job. I went into a photo laboratory to work, you know, processing stills and things like that, and tried to find contact, you know, with my friends who maybe will, you know, get me to Hollywood.
Did you speak any English at the
Not
time?
Not at all.
Not at all.
I didn't speak, but I mean, you know, I came to America without speaking one word of English.
My goodness.
I spoke French in those days.
Yes.
A little bit of German, but not English. So, I mean, that was, you know, probably, I mean, in the language-wise, but it was the worst choice, you know, to do, you know. So I got here, and then a friend of mine, actually, who spoke very well English, he got a Rockefeller Foundation. He got something like $5,000. And he actually saved all his money and wanted to do a short film.
And in Chicago?
Not at all. He was in New York.
He was in New York.
He was in New York, so I went to New York right away to be next to him.
Uh-huh. You
know, because we did student films together. We liked each other very much. So I found a job again in a laboratory in New York and waited to the moment when we go to California and do the short film. And next summer, actually, we did that.
So you worked for a year in New York City.
In New York City, and I bought a car.
Must have been a strange place for a young man from.
And I packed up everything. By that time, I had actually a family. I had a wife who I married in Vienna, Austria.
Ah.
So that's the other story, which we will actually my summer today. You know, we are going to make a movie of it probably. But anyhow, so I got married. A year later, we had a daughter. So my 6 months old daughter actually was in the back of the Pontiac what I bought, and my developing equipment, you know, what I actually bought. And we didn't take the short route because we also wanted to see Yellowstone Park and, you know. So
everything,
So we went around, you know, on the northern part, you know, North Dakota and all that, and ended up in Hollywood. And that's where I thought my movie career will start.
And what happened?
Well, it didn't start until about 10 years later.
Oh, no. So you got to Hollywood, and this would have been, what, about 1958 or so by this time?
It was 1958 in Hollywood, I was very eager, and I knew that I should get a job in Hollywood. But how do you get a job in Hollywood when you don't speak English?
Still couldn't speak real good English.
Well, I mean, to learn English.
It's very different than Hungarian.
First of all, you have to go to school, or you have to really dedicate yourself, you know, for a few years to learn English. So I had a problem because I had my little daughter and my wife, and I had to work. So when you work, you know, 8-10 hour days, and you are tired, and you don't have much time, you know, to learn English, you know. You learn English, the pidgin English kind of thing, you know, but at work, you know, when some, you know, people try to teach you, you know, and they teach you all the wrong things, you know, so it's...
So what did you do in Hollywood?
Well, I just, I got all kind of jobs, you know. I mean, I didn't select them too much. I tried to stay close to the smell of film, actually. So I did mostly microfilm printing, which was stupid. It was 60 millimeter. You know, all those documents in those days were not on computers.
Yes.
They were on microfilm. So I did a lot of microfilm printing for insurance companies.
Well, that must have been tough.
It was tough, but I took a night job so I can also work in the daytime. Yeah. In daytime, I selected actually children's photography.
Wow.
So I went from house to house and took
Still took pictures, yes.
And for the company, you know, I remember I got $1.25 for each sitting.
Oh, my goodness.
Every 20 minutes, I had a sitting. Every day, I had 20 sittings.
Oh.
All those rotten kids, you know, I mean, how to put them together. And, you know, I go back to the camera. When I went to the camera, they were already somewhere else, put them back on the chairs. So that was a hilarious job, you know. It was horrible.
But lighting and cameras.
Yeah, but it was... very primitive, you know. Very, very primitive. Oh, the very first job that you will like, that one. When we came to Hollywood and I didn't have a job, and we already finished our short film that we shot, you know, and my friend was editing, but we ran out of money. We didn't have any money at all. So we went for county help.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the county was helping refugees, you know. And they paid our motel bill and gave us, I don't remember, $10 a week, you know, for groceries.
Mm-hmm.
And they gave it to us for like 2 weeks. And they were trying to find jobs. I said, and they asked me that, what is my profession? I said, cinematographer. Cinematographer, you cannot get a job in Hollywood? I said, no, I can't. I said, that's right. Who did you try? Gave them a list, you know, that we went to everywhere, you know. We went to the IATSC, you know, Herb Aller was in those days.
Good luck.
and Herb actually kicked us out. They said, first you learn English, then you come back for a job. So the county says, oh, I'm sure we can get you jobs. There's no problem. And we have so many Hungarians in Hollywood, filmmakers. Said Zsa Gabor and Joe Pasternak and all that. We are saints. Don't worry, we get you a job. They went to all the Hungarians and nobody gave us a job.
Well, see, you were poor Hungarians as opposed to the rich ones, right?
Yeah, so what happens, 2 weeks or 3 weeks later, they could not find a job. And they said, well, listen, we could not get you a job. We are still looking for jobs for you. But now you have to start working for us, actually. You cannot just, you know, take this money from us. You have to go and work. And they sent me to Park La Brea. When today is so beautiful, and in those days it was nothing there yet, you know, just the tar pits.
Mm-hmm.
All that. So they took me over there and gave me a sack, put it on my neck. They gave me a stick with a nail at the end. So I'll go around the park and just pick up the cigarette butts, you know, and put it into the sack. So I show, you know, my friends many times, you know, where I started, actually, my Hollywood career was started at the La Brea pits.
Picking up trash. We've gone a lot further than that. What happened after, so you did it get better? Did you find better jobs?
Well, as soon as I started to learn my English, you know, I made some contacts with UCLA students who were actually studying film, and they needed some crazy Hungarian who can shoot, you know, pictures with them. So we started with Laszlo, we started to do these little student projects, you know, for them, you know, on 16 millimeter. And we became very popular in the circles of low-budget educational filming. We started to make a lot of educational films, documentaries. And I got into a place called Volper Productions, and in those days, actually, Dave Volper was doing a lot of television specials, and I got to shoot a lot of the series there, which was called The Story Of. It was an interesting series because they picked, every week they picked somebody, you know, like a basketball coach,
mm-hmm.
Freddie
mm-hmm.
Schultz, you know, was mm-hmm. the Lakers coach in those days, you know. So I was working with a guy named Billy Slapinex, you know, who was one of the greatest handheld cameramen of the days, you know. And I was working with him, and I was doing documentaries. I was very happy, you know, just to have a 60mm camera in my hand and do what I do the best, you know.
So this is by 1960-61?
Oh, this is like, I don't know, it's about, I would say 4 years, 5 years mm-hmm. after I came here, then 61, 62 or something like
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started to do commercials.
Mm-hmm.
And then I did start to do low-budget features.
Mm-hmm.
In those days, many little production companies were formed to do the so-called no-budget pictures. Mm-hmm. You know, not even low-budget, but we call them no-budget
features. No-budget features.
Yeah, some of those features were shot for $30,000, you know,
mm-hmm.
the whole film. And in fact, it's interesting that somebody actually wrote me a letter just last week. And they somehow dug up this film that I shot, which was my first black and white movie I ever shot in Hollywood, called The Sadist.
The Sadist?
The Sadist. And
I have it here. James Landis directed?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Black and white feature film. That would be right. Listed in 1963.
Okay. So this is the film, and they want to release it in video.
Oh, no.
And they want to interview me for this for this thing. And they even want to pay me for this interview. I said, what?
Did you look at it again?
I never got any offer ever in my life, you know, to get paid for an interview, right? They want to interview me and put it on the tape.
That's terrific. Well, let me just read some of these ones that you, around that time. Wild Guitar, Ice Hockey, Man with Many Trades, History, Story of a Champion, Story of a Coach for Wolper, Story of Debbie, Limelight, Five Cities Called Pomona documentary. It's the legends of Tavis Field, Hollywood. You got working is what I'm saying. You started getting busy, no matter what you did.
And you know what? I still didn't give up my job. You know, I had a job all these times.
Mm-hmm.
And all I told my producers, you know, that I will shoot pictures for them for $2.50 an hour.
As long as it's better than taking still photography of children.
I was at that time already. I was doing actually black and white enlargements for professional photographers.
And then things by 1964, Los Angeles freeways, snack shopping center, but What's Up Front? But that became a comedy filming technoscope. So that's
yes.
Trying to shoot widescreen even.
Well, that was the time actually when I bought my own camera. And see, this is was very difficult even to get those low-budget features in those days because there was many, many people who were doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And I figured it out that if I have my own camera, mm-hmm. my own lighting equipment,
mm-hmm.
I will get the job easier because I can compete with the others easier because I will be cheaper than anybody else.
Of
so
course.
I was working, you know, for $100 a day
mm-hmm.
with all the equipment.
With all the equipment included?
Everything.
Oh, my God.
My Aeriflex in a blimp. My eight Garnell lights and my tripods, everything that you need you actually to shoot a movie.
An Aerie 2C?
It was an Aerie 2C in a blimp.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because that was before, that was the camera. That was a good, strong camera.
And so you know, the thing was always to get paid for your job.
Because even if you did it, you had to still get paid.
Exactly. And
did you hold back the negative and sometimes and wait?
No. I didn't do that because I didn't. Dude, I always trusted people, and sometimes, you know, they didn't come through. But this first guy I worked with on the first low-budget picture, who is a famous guy by now, because you probably heard about this, because there was some newspaper article about Al Adamson, who was killed, actually, in the desert just about a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy, it was my first job on a low-budget picture, and he shows me a movie which he was shot on 16mm, and it was terrible. The lighting was terrible, everything was out of focus. And he said, what should he do? I said, well, start reshooting everything but you shot on 35.
There you go.
I said, 35? I don't have the money to shoot on 35. He said, just wait. How much you pay for the 16 film? So I figured it out that if he buys short ends in black and white and uses my camera, the technoscope, because my camera was actually turned into a technoscope camera which uses half amount of film.
So you had modified your camera?
Modified the camera and prove it to him that he can shoot it on 35 for less money and mm-hmm. he will have a better product.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, how much do I want for this? I said, $100 a day. Okay, he said, fine, you start shooting this weekend. So that's $200. The second day, he's directing also, you know, this guy who didn't know how to direct. I had to set up everything for him. But anyhow, at 5 o'clock he comes to me and says, you know, I have to go away for a few hours. Would you mind to direct this a couple of scenes and later I will come back and bring you your money. So I knew that he's not going to bring my money. No way he's going to bring my money. It was just a good ploy, you know, to get me shooting the first 2 days and he will show the film to some people and he will raise more money.
Mm-hmm.
Then he comes back actually, as he said, 2 hours later. In a big paper sack, full with $1 bills.
Oh no.
$200 in $1 bills, right? I said, where did you get this money? He said, well, you know, I mean, so I'm a producer, but I also need a job, so I'm delivering paper for the houses every day. And I collected my money for the people. He went to collect his money for the newspapers to pay me the $200.
But you got paid that time.
I got paid that time, and it's not only that. I respected this guy because of this.
He would go out and do that.
Which was a mistake. Because I shot so many films with him, and most of the time he didn't pay me. He always said that he's going to pay me next year, next month. He always dressed wonderfully. Always he drove beautiful new Cadillacs.
He was making money, but
and always saying that, you say that you can pay me. What is about this Cadillac? You know what about? Well, that's my father's car. I'm just using it. You know.
But you continued working all the time. It looks like you always had incredible amount of business going on because you had your own equipment. You were able to
exactly.
You were able to keep busy and pretty soon people started noticing you. It looks like. I mean, you have Job Corps, My Souls Run Naked. That's great. Or at least it's Rat Fink, The Nasty Rabbit, Deadwood 70. I mean, these certainly couldn't have been the highest end movies, but at least you were working.
Those were terrible movies, but it was a great experience for us. And we worked together with Laszlo mm-hmm. all the time, you know, that we had a great thing going with Laszlo because we helped each other's career all the time, you know, by helping each other to get jobs.
So he had found his way to Hollywood by this time, and you guys had hooked up
yeah,
again
yeah.
already.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We worked together on everything, you mm-hmm. know. It's like we were like brothers, basically. I mean, we were better than brothers. We were friends, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so nice, you know, when he needed a job, and I had too many, I always passed over my jobs, you know, because I could not do all. And he did the same thing with me. And many times when we had only one job, we worked for each other. He was my gaffer, my assistant, and I was his gaffer and his assistant.
Worked both ways.
We worked both ways and we always worked together, so.
And then by 1965, is this John Landis that you had represented?
Jim Landis is the guy who...
Jim Landis.
Who I did a couple of these low-budget pictures, and he was one of those interesting guys, you know, who I would like to work with. In fact, you know, he saved my life, you know, at one time, you know, which was incredible.
Tender Grass, The Cat, Road to Nashville, The Mark. I'm just going through to indicate
a lot, anybody, of, yeah,
a lot
yeah.
of a lot of shows, but documentaries by 66, the one Los Angeles Metropolis, The Wonderful World of Wheels. These sound like they're getting bigger because they're for television.
Yeah, now this is a little like The Wonderful World of Wheels. You know, it was a Peterson publishing production, actually, which was shown on television.
Mm-hmm.
Was a good project, and by then, you know, we started to make a little more money also.
Mm-hmm.
It's not only that we get more and more interesting projects because, you know, documentaries, I never looked down at documentaries because I think it's a great experience for mm-hmm. for us, you know, because it's good to work fast and try to do some lighting, you know, when you are working fast, and it's good good experience. And then also it led us into commercial filming pretty soon.
Well, the U.S. Water Polo, the House of Tomorrow, the documentary for Philco, sounds like you're getting bigger and bigger projects. You're coming up in the world. Now, right. You're starting to get a reputation. People are starting to notice you. Is this what's happening?
That was happening, actually, basically. I mean, the first places where they recognized us were the commercial companies. Mm-hmm. You know, commercial companies started to come up in those days. And in fact, the most interesting work in those days was done in commercials. Mm-hmm. It's not only that they had a lot of money to experiment. You know, we had new equipment, we had new lighting equipment and all that. So it was wonderful to do commercials because we learned a lot from them. The first film, basically, which I noticed actually of mine was Prelude. Mm-hmm. Prelude was a short film with John Astin, the actor.
Yes.
Directed.
He directed.
And it was a cute little film and was nominated for an Academy Award. Mm-hmm. Didn't win, but many of the producers and directors saw it actually in the Academy screenings and I got a lot of call because of Prelude.
What year would that have been about? That would have been by about which year would that have... Prelude, you said?
Prelude, yeah.
Oh, Prelude, 1969, John Astin, yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. 1969.
Yes. Well, I'm just trying to get a timeline. Because right. So that was a big break for you to get...
That film was a big break because it had a lot of attention, was nominated for an Academy Award, and even Universal Studios, they called me up and said, we saw your film and we are interested, you know, in some of our future movies, maybe, you know, we would like to talk to you.
Really?
Or and it happened actually because Peter Fonda did Hired Hand. Mm-hmm. That was his first movie produced by Universal. Mm-hmm. And Peter Fonda actually called me up, and it was not through Universal really, because by that time, Laszlo worked with Peter Fonda on Easy Rider.
Well, very soon afterwards, according to your filmography here, you start getting very big movies. McCabe and Mrs. Miller, which one of my favorites, a terrific. I understand it was, what we saw though as a release was not the movie that you filmed. It was very different, a lot of re-editing that was ended up. Is that true?
Well, you know, I think the changes are made in the script. Mm-hmm. Actually, it was not recut. It was, if you actually get a copy of the script, and we didn't really shoot the script, actually. Robert Altman and Warren Beatty, they were rewriting the script every night. Now they were, you know, writing for until midnight, and then next morning, you know, I walked to the set, and I said, well, Robert, what are we shooting today? And he said, well, this is the scene, this, you know. So it was nothing, I mean, we could not repair it too much, but, you know, by then I was really very good at improvising, you know, because all these low-budget films what I did, the documentaries, that was all improvisation, you know, basically. We could not prepare, I could not think about what I'm going to be shooting, so Robert says, okay, this is what we are shooting, and immediately I had to light it and shoot it. So
what was that? That was winter in...
Winter in Vancouver.
In Vancouver. And so it was those locations, and it wasn't on a stage at all.
It was nothing was on the stage. Everything was built. Mm-hmm. Built in a... actually, it was behind the development, actually. I mean, everybody thinks that we shot it way out in the forest somewhere, you know. It was just like 5 minutes away from West Vancouver.
Ah.
We went over the development, and we went over the ridge. We went on. There was this beautiful, pure location with a river and a lake.
A river through it, yes.
And we actually made the lake, actually dammed up that little lake by ourselves.
Where the shootout happened and they fell off the
And
the
we
ridge.
Built everything.
And you
every
built the
single
town.
House, the church and everything was built there. And the people actually who were the extras, they lived actually on the property. Because Robert Altman wanted to make something very authentic.
Well,
so people lived there. They cooked there, they slept there. And they built a bathhouse. The bathhouse, which is in the movie, was an actual bathhouse. They went there every night and they took a bath. In fact, actually, we had a still. We were making, actually.
And the opium dens were real?
Well, I don't know about that, you know. It could have been real in those days.
Probably
it was real, but...
But But that was one of the first of the anti-heroes. I mean, the definite, you know, the troubled hero. It wasn't, this was no John Wayne who was taking over the town with, you know, this was
right.
This was kind of a bad guy.
Well, we called it a Northwestern, actually.
A Northwestern.
The start of the Northwestern. And I enjoyed tremendously working on that film because it was just like it happening, you know. This was the days of the 60s, end of the 60s, I think.
But was that, I mean, if there's one place you could say there was a big break for you, would that have been the movie, or was there other?
I would say McCabe and Mrs. Miller was actually one of the breaks, because mm-hmm. That led me basically to shoot Deliverance.
And Deliverance, of course.
Because, you know, the way I shot Deliverance was, I mean, the way I got Deliverance was that John Borman did Deliverance in at Warner Brothers, and the dailies came to Warner Brothers every day. And John Borman happened to see some of the dailies
of McCabe
and Mrs. Miller. And he loved it so much because it was so unique, actually. I mean, in those days, somebody shoots, you know, very hazy images, flashed images. We did flashing on the film.
Yes, that's what I was going to ask you. You were using flashing at the time. Was McCabe flashed also?
Yes, oh yeah.
It was
heavily flashed.
10%? 15%?
Heavily diffused. 15, 20, 25.
Yeah. People
fog filters, fog one, fog two. I mean, it was very, very, it's like a fantasy. But
well,
it didn't look like a real film.
Time. No one did that much processing at the camera, or did they?
They were afraid to do that because, you know, even Warner Brothers hated the look of that film.
Really?
Oh, they hated it. And they wanted to stop doing it. That when then Robert Altman had to lie to them. He said that, listen, don't worry about it. This is just a... The print looks terrible. The negative is just okay. Print is terrible. Don't worry about it. It will be okay. When, I mean, he lied to them, and then they were stuck, and they hated the look of that movie.
Well, let's talk about flashing just for a second, because no one does this anymore. I mean, you would take and aim the camera at a white surface and photograph the... Is this how flashing works?
Well, you know, you can do it that way. If you do it like a little amateur film, you can do it this way.
How did you do the flashing?
I mean, we actually did it in the laboratory because we shot a lot of film, actually,
yes.
On McCabe. So the laboratory, the way they did it, actually, they run the film through an optical printer.
Mm-hmm.
And they gave that little tiny little exposure, white okay. haze flashing on the negative.
So the negative did not have the flash on. This was to the print?
No. Actually, what we did originally, we tested out whether we should pre-flash the film or post-flash the film.
Mm-hmm.
We found out, actually, that if you pre-flash the film, it has a tendency to, the flashing disappears after a couple of days because it's such a little amount of exposure that the film somehow regenerates itself and becomes like it was no flashing. But if you do the flashing right after the exposure and develop it right then the flashing is very constant. So that's what we did, actually, that every night the film went to the laboratory. They actually went through first the optical printer, putting that haze on, and they developed it.
Really? Very gutsy.
Very gutsy, and you know, we never had a problem with it. I mean, interestingly enough, this laboratory, Alpha Cine in Vancouver, they actually bought the machinery for us. They didn't have a 35-millimeter processing equipment until then. And Altman actually loaned the money to them to buy the machinery, you know?
Wow.
And because we had to pay for developing, so Altman had to just to give them the money ahead.
The reason I spend so much time with this is because you're always known for a look, and part of it is the willingness to try something. Would that be a fair statement, to try something different and unusual to get a look?
I believe in that each film has to look different. I mean, I really believe that each story, each screenplay, it's a different life. It should have a different look to it. I mean, of course, you know, not all of them can have a different look. Because, you know, you do Die Hard 1, Die Hard 2, Die Hard 3. I mean, of course, it's got the same look.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, McCabe and Mrs. Miller was definitely a different look, since it was playing 100 years ago, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Old times, you wanted to create some old, like sepia and faded look. I mean, it was natural to do that, basically. Now, Deliverance, it was a totally different movie.
Well, that looked almost like a documentary. It looked almost unlit. I mean, but I'm sure you lit it, but it has a more of a feeling that you're just there, you're watching them.
How did
you handle that?
It had to have a dramatic look also.
Yes.
So it had to have contrast, which McCabe didn't have contrast. It had the faded, hazy images. Mm-hmm. The Deliverance is the opposite. It had the blacks and the greens, and we actually controlled the colors. We were flashing also Deliverance for, the reason was we were flashing because we wanted to have a desaturated look.
Mm-hmm.
And we were shooting in April and May, and Georgia was very beautiful with a lot of beautiful flowers and yellowish green plants and all that. It was too colorful. So we decided to desaturate it a little bit. And also in the printing, we printed black and white into it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I mean, in those days, we still had the Technicolor plant, actually, a Technicolor,
mm-hmm.
which we could print as many percent black and white into any print we wanted to.
So that's how you got more contrast?
I mean, the old days, they did it on Moby Dick, and they did it on many of pictures, you know. So we decided to get that black and whitish look, you know, because it was stronger, more dramatic.
Well,
and it worked.
Deliverance was all on location. Was it a lot of handheld? It looked like you're in the water.
You're doing
the scenes. And the only scenes that were on land were at the farm. Was it just the beginning and at the end, seemingly, as I recall the movie.
Right.
It was a lot of wet work, as they say.
Yeah, it was very, very gutsy work actually, because we had to spend a lot of time in the water, because we figured out that the most exciting shots in the rapids was when we put the camera right to water level. And we didn't have underwater housing, actually. We didn't need that because we shot mostly everything with long lenses. So we did it in a very primitive way. We just covered up the fluid head, you know, with plastic, and we actually submerged the fluid head into the water. And only the lens was above water.
So on a tripod in the water?
On a tripod. And we just, you know, panned across through the rapids and the canoes, and it looked like we were traveling with them.
Yes.
In fact, it looked better because, you know, we made tests. And we were traveling side by side with the canoe. It was not as interesting.
Oh, yes, it was.
Not as interesting than do it with a long lens, which gives you more speed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that was very interesting to do it that way. And
was that another 2-3-5 wide angle? Wide
all of my early movies were actually anamorphic.
Anamorphic?
You know? All of them, except, if I remember, I think Hired Hand was the only film which was not anamorphic. Before that, I did Technoscope, anamorphic movies.
Mm-hmm.
Hired Hand was just 185. And then from that point on, everything was anamorphic.
And being an anamorphic camera, that puts you in a different league. Jan de Bont talked about the anamorphic camera, the wide aspect ratio as being, this puts you in the more artistic. Did you find that? People saw you as that type of a photographer?
Well, you know, the audiences actually were reacting more to the anamorphic than today, actually. In those days, I think, when they advertised, you know, widescreen or anamorphic, audiences went to see them easier than just a normal film. It was a selling point.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you remember, television became big in those days.
Mm-hmm.
Television tried to take away the market from the film goers. The only reason the film productions could fight back was the anamorphic format.
Big picture and a
big picture. So you have to bring the audiences back into the big screens.
Mm-hmm. And so that became the selling point of it.
Right.
Vilmos, we have done an hour, do you believe, already?
Then let's stop for a second.
Let's take a break. And this has been delightful so far. Thank you.
Great.
Okay. Smile. Vilmos.
Right.
Okay, we're back. And we were just enjoying some of your hospitality and talking some war stories out in your kitchen. It's a lovely house you have here. Who's it? You said the actress.
The actress was Pearl White, actually, who did the Perils of Pauline in the early 30s, I think.
Yeah. Well, this is just a beautiful.
And
example.
She lived in Florence somewhere doing a movie, and she loved that house so much that she brought the plans back into Hollywood and rebuilt the house she used to live
in Florence.
Which I am dying to find that house in Florence. You know what? I never had time to do that.
Well, this is a perfect example of Hollywood architecture from the 20s or 30s, whenever we came about, but it's just gorgeous up here. When we last saw you, when we were talking about Deliverance, and we were getting into a little bit of the technique of how you were doing the flashing, and you were doing the water photography on tripods in the water. That movie also it was a strong action adventure movie. I mean, this is not your two people talking in a living room type of a situation. This was a big show. Talk about this for a second.
It was a very interesting film because first of all, it was a very great writing by James Dickey, who is a poet. I think he just died actually. I think a year ago, I think even less. It's a wonderful story. It's very American and it's very interesting. And Burt Reynolds thinks that this is the best movie he ever did, and I'm sure he's right because he's very, very good in this movie. And I love to work with John Borman. I mean, John Borman is a European director, and I love European directors. For some reason, you know, they know more about the craft than American directors do. You know, but John Borman knows more about the camera and everything, you know, but American directors usually don't get into it.
He's an Englishman.
Englishman, yeah. And I had a great relationship with him, you know. It was a very friendly relationship. And it's a shame I never did another picture after that with him, you know. I would love to work with him, you know.
Mm-hmm. But Was it a difficult movie to make?
You know, it looks difficult, but it was so well organized, that movie, that we pre-planned everything to the point that we knew how we are going to shoot everything. You know, we had to go down to the river by jeeps, mm-hmm. and we had to take the rubber boats down and the canoes, and we were part of the whole expedition, basically. We went down with the equipment, and we didn't have much room for a lot of people. So what happened basically, that Bill Butler, who was my Chicago standby DP, mm-hmm. he was operating the second camera with me. Mm-hmm. We didn't have operators. We had two assistants, two of us, the four of us, and Bill Butler and Borman, and the actors. That's it. That was the whole crew, you know, going down on the river. And we had a point, you know, where we broke for lunch, and a jeep again brought some lunch for us. And in the afternoon, we went down on the river again the same way. It was like an expedition shooting, you know.
Was it a big lighting complement to setups?
Was absolutely no lighting at all, actually. Really? I mean, many of the scenes that we shot at the river was no lighting, except the big scene, you know, when they killed this guy who was almost killing them, you know, when mm-hmm. they killed this guy. And there's a big discussion about what to do with the body, what to do with this whole situation.
It was up on the bank.
It's going on, you know, it's in the forest.
In the forest,
off of the river.
Side, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that was a big problem because it was like going on for 10 pages or more, 12 pages. And the light changes. And, you know, being deep in the forest, the light only got in there around noontime. Mm-hmm. You know, going through the leaf, it came down, filtered. So in order to match that kind of a lighting all day, we had to bring in lights. Mm-hmm. And we had those wonderful new xenon lights in those days, which just came out. Mm-hmm. And we used the xenon lights, and we actually cut down some branches, and we filtered the light through the branches, so we could maintain the look of that scene, you know, all day long, basically, by doing this technique.
Wonderful.
And we shot there for 5 days, actually, for that one scene.
And that was the turning point of the movie.
Well, it's a big scene, and it's basically based on dialogue, and it brings out all the characters, you know, what they think about the thing, and then finally they have a decision, and they bury the guy, and then they go on with their life, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and they decide you don't have to tell anybody about it, so they will, you know, keep quiet about the murder.
Well, that was Deliverance. That was '72. That's we have so many movies that you've done since that were just terrific. Several people keep reappearing. Steven Spielberg, Sugarland Express. That was almost his first feature. But before we go, you did the Long Goodbye, Scarecrow, Cinderella,
yeah.
Liberty.
The Long Goodbye, I would like to talk a little bit about because
you won a National Society of Film Critics Best Cinematography Award. It says.
It was an interesting film, and you know, shows a little bit of. The difference between what we think is good of photography and what sometimes the critics and the audience think is good photography. And that really brought out, that's an interesting subject, you know. Because I actually inherited the crew from Robert Altman to do that picture. Actually, I could not bring my own guys because he wanted me to use his crew, mm-hmm. which I was very unhappy about it because I usually like to work with my own gaffer, my own key grip, my own assistants.
Well, they're used to your system.
Yes, I'm used to it. And Robert wanted to use his people, which was fine. But also he brought me an operator, actually, who was actually a nice guy, and Robert wanted to help him out. And he was actually an African-American. And he was, he didn't have much experience, and Robert wanted to help his career, you know. And I was very unhappy about it because I, you know, for me, operating is a very important thing. That's why usually I operated always on my movies. Mm-hmm. No, this was this guy, you know, who Robert wanted to help him and wanted to, and I had to give him the camera to operate. So it's pretty much, you know, remembering my days in Hungary where my teachers gave me the camera to operate and they gave up, you know, part of themselves in order to help my career, right? So I was so unhappy about the operating all the time, and I said, Robert, you know, I'm really unhappy about it. Robert says, don't worry about it. When you will get that Academy Award for that movie, you will change your mind about it. Well, of course, I never got the Academy Award for the movie, you know, but it got the National Film Critics Award for Best Cinematography.
There you go.
You know, and I didn't like the operating, but I didn't like many of the things in the movie anyhow, which was crazy, very experimental. Like we moved the camera in every direction, every shot. That means that we were dolling left to right, right to left. We had the camera on a dolly going up and down, and we had the zoom lens going in and out on every single shot.
Ah.
And we were, you know, and then besides that, but I mean, after this, the operating, how bad can it be, right? I mean, it was funny that when the annual, when even now, when I look back at that picture, and I try to analyze that, why did the critics thought that it was best cinematography? And the only reason I can come up with is that by moving the camera all the time, especially laterally, it gives you an incredible third dimension to the pictures.
Yes.
You know, it immediately, the two-dimensional picture becomes three-dimensional. Because that movement is give you the third dimension.
Mm-hmm.
Because people are, I mean, persons are related to the background. I mean, you make the camera move a little bit, suddenly it becomes 3D. And that's probably what the film that people liked about it, you know.
Let's see, The Scarecrow, Cinderella Liberty, Mark Rydell, Sugarland Express. Well, that was with Steven Spielberg. Now, that was one of his earlier movies. I mean, he was
that was actually his first feature film movie.
Mm-hmm.
He did one feature film
Drive.
Before, but that was made for television.
Mm-hmm.
This was his first feature film for movie theater produced by Dick Zanuck. And that was a good project, actually. I really loved Steven Spielberg. I thought he was a great kid, you know, quote unquote. He was a kid in those days, you know.
Sure.
Really, I mean, I don't know how many years older, you know, and he actually wanted me to shoot his picture because he felt that he didn't have enough experience. He wanted to learn a lot from me.
Mm-hmm.
And it was funny, you know, that how fast he learned. It was incredible to just see him. I mean, I personally thought that he didn't need to learn anything because he was really accomplished by then. Mm-hmm. You know, he had ideas, but I never thought about it. No other directors thought about it, you know. Moving the camera in every shot, the way he moved the camera from and car to car shots, and, you know, doing that incredible shot, you know, when a police car is coming in one road and we are shooting actually him from another road from a camera car, and we meet at the intersection and keep traveling together, you know, for like a couple hundred yards, and there's dialogue involved with it and all that. I thought it was an incredible shot. And I mean, I love those ideas that he came up with always and every day.
Well, he always is one to use all the smart ideas and bring in new dimensions and bring in all the technologies that you probably fit into a movie. And, but it was there. You got a lot of recognition for that one also? Did people start seeing?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's that, I don't know if that picture was tremendously successful, actually.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, you know, Steven doesn't like to talk much about this picture. I don't know why. I think it's one of his most brilliant movies. But he somehow, he doesn't want to talk about it because he didn't make any money. I mean, I think Steven into big money, actually. All his movies, you know, went through the roof and all that. And since this picture didn't make a lot of money, he doesn't think it's great. But I think it's one of his greatest movies. It's very human. The characters are very recognizable.
Sure.
And it's a wonderful movie.
Hmm. Let's see, we'll go three quickly through some and stop at others. But The Girl from Petrova, Sweet Revenge, Obsession, Brian De Palma. You always liked working with Brian.
Yeah, we did three pictures, I think, with Brian De Palma. I did, and the very first one, Obsession, actually was a great experience for me, because first of all, the first time I went back to Europe to do two weeks of shooting in Florence, and that was marvelous, you know, to capture the late afternoon light there and early morning light and the bridges and beautiful architecture and
good set of ready.
And I thought it was great. And then we finished the picture in New Orleans, which also very interesting city. And Brian De Palma is a very interesting director. You know, he never does everything the same way, and he always comes up with crazy beautiful shots. You know, his 360s. You know, when he, you know, designed those shots. You know, the camera has to go 360. And you are struggling where to put the lights, you know.
Where do you put them? Up in the ceiling someplace?
You have to put them somewhere. Either put them on the floor, then you bounce them back from the ceiling, or put them on the ceiling if you can.
Well, now, by this time, are you in pre-production? I mean, do you get involved early in the pre-production, try to design a look with the art director, with the director? How are you approaching movies by this time? I mean, I'm looking for how it evolves.
You know, good directors like to work a lot of time with the cameraman pre-production, you know. That first of all, directors have so many things to do before the picture starts, and directors know that that he only will have to be able to spend part of his time with the cinematographer. So let's say if I am on a picture 6 weeks before the picture starts, that doesn't mean that I had 6 weeks contact with the director, because I'm lucky if I had maybe 5 full days with the director, you know, to talk over the things. But I always like to make a point to find out what the director has in his own, in her mind. But that's the important thing for me, because I cannot start out with something which is different than the writer's idea or the director's idea. I mean, the whole thing has to be together. I mean, whatever the director wants, that's what I want.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't like cinematographers work with them who just go out and do their own thing. And they would even tell the director, listen, just leave the camera work for me. You just deal with the actors. I mean, that's not what the director's job is. The director is the boss for me. I mean, the director is really the one who should really keep the control of the whole movie together.
Mm-hmm.
And if the director doesn't have that, I will push him to get that. You know, I will try to get the director to make up his mind or her mind, you know, that what is this picture about? How does it have to look?
So you do know? This by looking at the script and then developing how the characters, I mean.
I read the script and I have a certain idea about it, but I'm not sure if that's the same as the director has.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's very important that you get together with the director, find out what his or her idea is about it.
Mm-hmm.
That's the important thing. And if he doesn't have one, he should have one.
Mm-hmm.
You
mm-hmm.
have to develop that.
Develop that, yes.
You know, because without that, what's going to happen to the picture?
And are you
just make a picture? I mean, just make another picture. And this is the whole thing, that whenever I start shooting a picture, I don't want to just do another picture. I want to make that look different than anything what I did or anything what other people did. I want to have a stamp on that one picture. And I want to make it look like a unique experience.
So do you go for with the art director? Do you work with a color scheme and with a light scheme and with Vittorio talks about his color palette. Do you work with that sort of a theme in mind?
But you know, I work with the production designer.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I mean, the production designer is a very, very important person in my mind. You know that many times I would do a picture, I would represent not only because I like the director, but because I like the production designer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, you know, people like Dean Tavalodis or and Vic and Paul. Can't remember.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. So I love to work with. Let me start this again. Yeah,
of course.
Of course, you're not cutting this.
No, of course we're not cutting it. So it's all going. No. The comments you made are all very good. No. This would be great. Just what you're saying is okay. But you like.
Silbert. I wanted to mention actually Dick Silbert.
Okay.
Dick Silbert, who I did, Sliver with him. And
that was a very highly designed movie.
I mean, it's wonderful to work with production designers who are artists.
Mm-hmm.
And it's part of my job. They really make my job much easier when they have a designer. Then I can come in and with lighting and camera moves and with the director, we can do something interesting. But if you have a weak production designer, you have nothing to start with. Mm-hmm. You just think about it. Now what do you do now? Mm-hmm. I walk into a room and it's not designed right. Now what? I'm going to throw shadows in the wall that I don't like. But it happens many, many times,
Yes.
Many times it happens that I have to help the picture by trying to see what is there wrong and try to light the important things and keep things in the shadow which are not important or disturbing. It happens many times.
Well, I bring that up because, these, even in early movies, your look, your stamp that you say is on your movies.
But Scarecrow, that was a wonderful movie. It's mm-hmm. one of my early movies. Not many people even know about this movie today. It's such a great movie about friendship. Mm-hmm. Gene Hackman, Al Pacino, mm-hmm. two hobos meet on the road, and one is a loner. He doesn't want to do anything with the other guy. The other guy is more open. He would like to make this other guy a friend. It's such a great movie, and the way it ends and everything, it's a wonderful movie. Jerry Schatzberg at his best.
Let's see, Obsession, we talked a little bit about that.
We started to talk about Brian De Palma, that I did
Brian
Obsession,
De Palma.
And then I did my next picture with him was Blowout, I think.
Blowout, yes, several years later.
Yeah, Blowout, we did it in Philadelphia in a very cold weather. It was a big picture, big exterior night scene in a cold weather. That was
a bomber movie, wasn't it? Blowout, about a terrorist?
No, actually, it is actually, if you saw the movie Blow Up by
yes.
Antonioni,
yes.
Brian De Palma basically changed the character. He's not a photographer, he's a sound engineer.
Yes.
And John, and then Travolta is basically a sound man
mm-hmm.
who experiences with his sound recording machine actually a murder.
That's right.
And that's where the whole picture starts. And it's like Blow Up. Mm-hmm. But it takes on a totally different shape, with sound and all that.
And then you did Bonfire of the Vanities with Brian also.
That's right.
And it was the start of all those marvelous Steadicam shots and motion and movement and a very glamorous looking movie.
Yeah, that's the first time I worked with actually Garrett Brown, and I was just admiring, his ability to move that.
Well, that was 10 years later. Let's continue our progression
okay,
here
all right.
Because there's so many other good movies. Because after Obsession and Winter Kills of 76, and then you got back with your old friend Steven Spielberg and did Close Encounters of the Third Kind. Now that was a big movie.
That was a big movie actually. It didn't start out as a big movie, and then you always laugh about it. That picture basically started out as an $800,000 small low budget movie. Being done in 16mm. That's how it started, in Steven's mind. And then it started to grow, and it grew, and it grew, it grew, and became the $40 million movie, which was almost a top budget film of those days, And
oh, yes.
Everybody was very scared, if that picture is going to make the money back. And luckily, it made the money back,
Some of the biggest stages ever used?
Well, we had actually an airplane hangar actually in Mobile, Alabama, which was 600 feet long,
oh my goodness,
200 feet wide, and 150 high.
That was for the end where the big landing was.
That was actually half of the picture basically played there. Mm-hmm. We built a big set there, That was where the mothership landed.
The mothership landed, yes.
And it was an incredible scene with incredible amount of lights. What we used. I mean, we used. all the lights what was free, and they could take down to from Hollywood in those days, you know. All the arcs, you know, came down, all the HMI lights what we had, and 10Ks and 5Ks and so many lights. And it was interesting because it was never budgeted that way.
No, it was originally much smaller.
But was budgeted much smaller, and it just grew. It just grew, well, and it became more and more light effects. And Doug Trumbull was involved with it, was one of the greatest designers of the days, you know.
Well, this was one of the first movies that used a lot of special effects, where, you know, the spacecraft flying through the air, and
The first time he used the motion control.
Motion control, yes.
First time ever used motion control for a shot.
Mm-hmm. Did that intimidate you or scare you, or you envisioned what just
no,
used it?
Everything was again so well pre-planned, you know. I mean, Steven is a good organizer, you know. He storyboarded everything, you know, which was happening on that set. And in fact, you know, part of the problems were actually, I mean, I have so many anecdotes of all my movies. I mean, this is one of the anecdotes that when we started our Close Encounters of the Third Kind, shooting inside the set where we had so many special effects to do, and we had, every day, we had four storyboards, basically, to shoot. Each storyboard basically meant one sequence.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean one shot, but it's one sequence. But each four storyboard had to be shot on the same day. So let's say that you have 3 hours for every sequence.
Mm-hmm.
Now, while we were shooting the movie, Steven always got better ideas. He was watching movies at night, you know,
mm-hmm.
old movies, and I always got some great ideas, you know.
Yeah.
The next morning he comes in and says, guess what? We are going to do 6 storyboards today. Because I added 2. So, you know, the schedule became more and more difficult for us, you know, to try to be on schedule and on budget.
Well, and so many effects, too, were just big light effects. I mean, it was just like blasting, you know, like
exactly. And my gaffer actually came up with a one-liner, you know, one day when Steven was complaining about that we were slow or we were not accomplishing the day's work. And finally, my gaffer said, Steven, if you would just stop watching those fucking movies every night, you know, we would be back on schedule.
But even the light organ at the end, do-do-do-do-do and all that, I mean, you had to, you know, have a lot of, you know,
it was a great
control.
It was a great creativity actually coming from Steven in that movie. It was really, really a master director actually doing one of his first big movies, you know, that's what it was, you know.
Big movie. And it got the recognition, the British Academy Award nomination for it, and Academy Award, that was...
Academy Award here, yes. Uh-huh.
That's had to be a thrill.
That was a thrill, and that was I didn't suspect it really that I'm going to get it.
You get up in front of everybody to say thank you?
I know, and I was so scared to death. Actually, I mean, first of all, I really didn't think that I'm going to get it because it was so many other pictures also that year which would have deserved, you know, the award. Star Wars, you know, one of them.
Yes.
And Julia, I think, was another one.
Well,
That was very interesting that the Academy voters thought that this was a movie about light.
Yes. Yes, it was.
And, you know, it was about light.
Yeah.
And I am so happy that they recognized that the cinematographer's major work is lighting.
Well, now,
you know?
I heard that you used aircraft lights and you know, huge things. One question, foot candles. I mean, how many hundreds of, or was it thousands of foot candles or some of those effects?
We could not even measure it because we just used the most what we could get.
It
was not enough, actually, but we used the most what we could get. You know, sometimes, I mean, the distances were, the size of the set was so big that when I turned on one arc, in an area, it was like turning a candle on.
We didn't get to the other end of the...
You had to bunch up 3 brutes together, turn them on at the same time, you know, in order to have an effect on. And when you want to do a color effect, and you put color gels on, the effect disappeared. So we had to actually punch holes in the middle of the gel, you know, in order to have some light going into there, you know, with some color, in order to make an effect.
Wow.
I mean, we didn't really have strong enough lights, really, to do that picture right. But what we did was the best what we could do in those days.
I thought you did pretty good.
We did.
I thought you did pretty good. Continuing on, The Last Waltz, which was a very pretty movie, but The Deer Hunter then was the next one on your filmography. That's going from a sci-fi movie to a war movie and a really a feeling movie, a reaction to it. How did that work for you?
I love the story of The Deer Hunter, actually. It was, I love to work with Cimino, actually, especially on that movie. I thought that he was one of the best directors of the times, and the way he cast that picture was marvelous, actually. Every single character of the movie was a great actor, you know. Meryl Streep, Robert De Niro, Christopher Walken, John Cazale, mm-hmm. I mean, all these actors, you know, were basically from New York. They were incredible actors who formed their characters, shaped their characters through the movie. And the story was very interesting about this little town, you know, where the steel mill town, you know, where the people have their small little life, and then suddenly Vietnam, the war comes in and then takes the people away and changes everything and all. And what happens to these characters, I think it's so interesting. And what made the picture very, very good, actually, in those days, that was the time, you know, when the Vietnam veterans were really not cared about at all. I mean,
they
were then neglected, despised, and you know, because they were fighting a wrong war and all that. And this picture somehow wanted to set the record straight that these people didn't know it was a wrong war. They were just, you know, trying to do the best what they could do, trying to be, you know, patriotic as much as they can do. And I think the success of the movie was that somehow we recreated, I mean, we put the whole war into a different perspective.
Well, it certainly worked on all those emotional levels, but you had such different looks. You had the war look and then the Pittsburgh or the steel town look, and then after the war you had a very distinctly different look, and then the mystical up on the mountain experience of them hunting and giving up the deer when he could have downed it. You know, all those things. Talk about that. I mean,
basically, you know, it was three movies in one, basically. Because you had three segments, basically. The beginning segment, which is a sort of romantic old-time town, you know, where people are very friendly with each other and they have fun and all that. So that had one sort of a golden, warm look to it, you know, very pleasant, very nice look.
And you did and that with camera filters, or was it?
Well, we did use some gels, you know, warming gels, you know, like CTOs, and contrasted with the bluish moonlight exterior look, you know. And that I would call the sort of romantic, interesting, romantic look. Then the war was like a documentary, you know. That we had to match a lot of documentary footage in that movie. You might not realize that, but there's a lot of sequences that they use original Vietnam documentary footage.
Really?
And we had to match our footage, which meant to deteriorate our footage to the level where the documentary footage was, which meant, you know, to push the film three stops and overdevelop it. And
go for the grain.
And for the grain and all that, and duplicate it many times.
Mm-hmm.
And that even, I mean, Eastman Kodak film by then was so good that you could not actually destroy it by pushing it, you know. You had to really, you know,
You had to insert
dupe it several times in order to get a dupey look, you know.
Sure.
So that's what we had to do for that sequence. And the third sequence is a sort of back to normal, but not really normal. It's more like a desaturated.
Mm-hmm. Back when the war, when he had the uniform on and he went to the bar and
autumn look, you know, it's a sort of sad, sort of sepia tones with a lot of blacks and shadows. So that was a sort of a third look of the movie. And you know, all cinematographers love to make movies that you can play with different looks. Obviously, you know.
And then up on the mountain was the
the hunting. The hunt was great. I mean, we were so lucky. It's not only luck. It takes actually determination from a director, you know, to sometimes get something unusual. I know we were in Washington State, you know, mm-hmm. near Bond Baker. Mm-hmm. We were actually in a motel, you know, just next to this big mountain where we were doing the scene. And we were fogged in for 3 solid days.
And you had to wait it out.
You had to wait and not shoot a thing. But we were always ready to go at any moment when the fog is going to break or the clouds are going to move. And that's what happened on the 4th day in the morning. We always went up in the mountain just in case something happened.
Look at the spots you wanted to
and as we were there in the morning at 8 o'clock, we saw the clouds move. Immediately radio down, you know, to Robert De Niro to get up right away. And Robert De Niro, being such a professional, you know, he was dead in 10 minutes, was ready to shoot. And with another actor, probably we could not have got there. We saw actually in the scene when you see the clouds moving across the bridge and he's going after the deer. And it was such a beautiful scene. It was just lucky to be there.
Did you have a deer wrangler? I mean, to push the deer out there?
Actually, many of those shots, you know, imported scenes, we didn't have a deer in it. Because, you know, first of all, it's hard to find, to see a deer. It was hidden. And, you know, we had a prop man who had some antlers, you know, so that was a deer. And then when he had to kill the deer, actually, we had a deer wrangler, and we had actually medics there, you know, doctors who, we didn't kill a deer, of course, you know, it's prohibited in a movie in America, you know, to kill a deer for a shot.
Of course.
But it looked like we killed a deer. You know, it was unbelievable. We had to paint a little red spot, you know, on the deer. Mm-hmm. After, you know, and we used, how do you call it, a gun, you know, when mm-hmm. we actually...
Squib gun?
It's not really a gun. It's like a little metal thing, which you know, something, you know, which has some sedative in it.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. So you actually get the deer sedated, and we were waiting there with the camera set up, right? And the deer was actually caught, was in a cage, and we sedated actually the deer, and we were waiting for like 5 minutes, 6 minutes when the drug is going to actually affect the deer. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then when we saw that happening, I mean, they just opened up the cage, the deer was walking on, and he had to somehow figure out that what the deer is going to do. So we had to think like a deer, with a deer's brain, that deer probably is going to go downhill because he feels so tired and it was going to go downhill. So we set up the cameras in the right spot where the deer collapsed, actually looked like he died, you know. It was unbelievable, but 2 cameras at the same time.
The right spot.
And you would swear, you know, that they saw a deer dying, and it didn't. Actually, it was amazing, you know.
Well, that was a wonderful movie. It really became kind of a closure for a lot of people that they were able to say they returned home because they've experienced this in the movies.
Another thing I forgot to mention, that of course in Hollywood many times you have to shoot a winter movie in the summer.
Yes.
A summer movie in the winter.
Yeah.
We have to shoot actually the fall in Pittsburgh in May, right?
Yes.
May in Pittsburgh, which is again, you know, a lot of green leaves and trees and all that. We have to take all the leaves off of the trees and the plants and things like that. We have to actually spray the grass.
Make it brown.
To make it brown.
Oh, my.
And you know, they wrote an article in the Cinematographer magazine about that, what we had to do with this, and how happy we were when actually the next year the leaves came back on the tree, because we were afraid that the tree might die.
Yeah, yeah.
And we were so happy that they didn't do any harm for the ecology. And there was this professor, I think, from Chicago, who wrote me a nasty letter, you know, that how did I dare to do this for a movie? Like it was my fault, right?
Oh, yeah, well, they blame everything on the cinematographer, you know that. after the Deer Hunter, you did The Rose, and then you came back with Michael Cimino and did Heaven's Gate. And there's so many stories about the wonderful photography, but the very difficult situations and how it almost ruined the studio and all that stuff. But
well, actually,
I thought it was a beautiful movie.
Actually, it did ruin the studio, actually, but the studio could have saved that movie if they were not so vindictive about Michael Cimino.
They were mad at him for something.
They hated him so much that they didn't mind if the studio goes down just to get Michael Cimino out of business or something.
Really?
Like.
Is that bad?
It was really, really bad, very bad blood, you know. And it's really a shame because when you look at that movie today, I mean, it's nothing wrong with that movie. It may be slow, it may be, for some people, maybe boring, or maybe not accurate to the history, or that can, you know, bring a lot of questions about that movie. But I think it was a brilliant work by Michael Cimino, and certainly was one of my best work. And
well, the Johnson County Wars were a real thing, and they really was very
they
real.
Enlarged.
And there were really some bad stuff happened between ranchers and farmers, and this was typical of a lot of the West, not just Johnson County. So it was a, you know, people complain. I mean, they think John Wayne, did he do the Alamo accurate? I don't think so.
No,
you know, so.
Nobody.
There's a lot of people take liberties with,
yeah,
with to make a movie.
A movie doesn't have to be the real thing. I mean, yeah, you know, I mean, the movie didn't claim that this was history, you know.
It was based on history, but it wasn't wasn't a documentary.
Yeah, it was not. It didn't have to be. But it's really such a shame because you know, the studio made that film die. And I tell you, I talked to Storaro actually that year, and he said that he did actually, I think in that year, he did Apocalypse Now, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Or what name, I don't know which word. But he was sure that I'm going to get the Academy Award for Heaven's Gate.
Mm.
For the cinematography, and it didn't happen because they didn't even show it to the Academy members.
They didn't have one
screening for the Academy members.
The studio didn't back it at all. Then.
No,
not at all.
Absolutely not.
I mean, Heaven's Gate. I recall the roller skating rink, the immigrants, the immigrants' areas and their housing with the dense atmosphere and the clouds and the dust. I mean, that was beautiful. Did you have to wait for the right time of day for the right backlight, or is this a...
Well, you know, we sometimes waited for the light, but you know, that's, again, we put a style into that picture. It's like pretty much like on McCabe and Mrs. Miller, we were playing with flashing and fog filters. In this movie, we didn't really do actually much flashing, but what we did. No, but I want to say that we did some flashing. In fact, actually, we did the flashing in the negative. We did flashing on the print,
mm-hmm.
but we didn't use any fog filters. Because we used so much dust in the air and smoke that we didn't have to.
The atmosphere
was created by that. So it's, again, but you know, the look is pretty similar to Mackie and Mrs. Miller, but on a different level. So again, I think. What did I want to say about this?
Well, I loved it. I thought it was a great movie, and I think it was quite a bit mistreated, as you indicated. You know, we're getting close to the end of our interview. Let's quickly go through quickly. How can we go quickly? The River, another Mark Rydell, Mel Gibson movie. That was another water. That's a recurring symbol.
It's actually
your movie.
A flood and rain and. Again, a character story, and I love to deal with people.
Mm-hmm.
I love to make movies which is about people, and I think Mel Gibson and Sissy Spacek and the kids, you know, they were wonderful actors, and I like films, you know, where the actors bring a lot of character to the story, and you know, in a way, it was funny because I took that movie to Hungary and they actually accused me that we did a socialist realist movie in America, you know, which was interesting, you know, their comments, you know, that yeah, it was about, you know, the poor people versus the rich people.
True.
And,
taking away his land.
What's wrong with that? It happens all the time
all
in
the
America,
time.
You know, that you have a power struggle between the rich and the poor, and it's nice, actually, to bring that up in movies.
And that you got an Academy Award nomination for that. The No Small Affair. Real genius, and then Witches of Eastwick, which was a lot of fun with Jack Nicholson playing
Yeah, Jack was really fun to work with. You know, he's quite an actor. I mean, he can do anything he wants to do, and he really felt great in that role. You know, he has this devilish character in himself. You know, and we had a great time with him, and he took me to shoot his movie next time, and he did two Jakes. Oh. He directed two Jakes, and I went to shoot that for him, and I had a great time with him there too. You know, he's.
I'll never be able to eat cherries again that way. But it, again, there was no Eastwick had a luxury look, and then it had kind of the devilish look when the girls were whipping up their spells, and you know, and then you had you know, it was a delightful photography. That was George Miller.
It was fun. Actually, it was fun. Actually, it was a comedy, and it was a black comedy, but we didn't shoot it like a comedy. I mean, I don't believe shooting comedy as comedy. I mean, that you don't have to bring up the fill light or bring up the light, you know, just because we are shooting comedy. We shot it straight like it was drama, and that's nice, you know, to be able to do that.
And then you did Journey to Spirit Island, which was more of a film festival award. Batman and Little Boy, that was a period piece, a World War II movie.
Yeah, it was basically the story of the atomic bomb. Mm-hmm. And we shot everything in Mexico. We spent a lot of money on building the sets. You know, we had to recreate the whole camp, you know, where the scientists mm-hmm. actually worked at the bomb in Los mm-hmm. Alamos. And it was a big undertaking, actually.
So your movies go from period pieces to then the two Jakes, which was, again, you just started to talk about that. Now you're talking mm-hmm. about another kind of period piece, but much more yeah. city and private eye type of stuff. So you have these nice shifts of style.
That's what's nice to do, you know, that you don't repeat yourself. You know, you always try to pick pictures which are different from the earlier one, and you have to come up with a new look, a new photography for that, and that makes it exciting for everybody, not for me, but the people who work around me. I mean, everybody is involved with it, and it's a community effort. You know, mm-hmm. everybody works on the same goal.
And then Bonfire of the Vanities, we talked about, just touched on it, but again, a modern show, a modern movie, modern times movie. So you had another shift in look. The Long Shadow. Now, this one you said you directed.
Yeah, I directed that movie. It's the only directing job I did in a feature. I did a lot of directing in commercials.
Do you feel comfortable?
I used to have my own company mm-hmm. for about 5 years and directed a lot of commercials. And this was my only try to do a feature. And I really enjoyed working with Liv Ullmann and Michael York in a story which was not really great, but we enjoyed working on it anyhow. And
what it would be directing, I mean, listen, we must come back and talk to you much more. Can we do this another time and
sure.
talk about all this? I mean, there's a
sure,
lot
we can
of
go
tech.
Back, go back and, yeah.
Okay, good. Because we'll go finish the rest of Jesus. Sliver was a much more stylized movie. That was almost science fiction, the way he had his place wired up for viewing purposes.
For viewing purposes, you know. But it was a pretty nasty story, actually, Sliver, you know. Mm-hmm. In a way, I didn't like the way it was cut at the end, you know. It was very badly cut, and you know why? Because they preview pictures nowadays, you know, and then the picture
yes.
doesn't succeed, for the preview audiences, they will reshoot some sequences, they will change the story, and try to make it successful.
And what audience that may look at a movie may not be the general audience that the public ends up doing, so they're really cutting for a very select group that may not be your
exactly.
finished audience.
And you know, Sliver, at the beginning, it was we had a moral story there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, we had a moral story where the Baldwin character, you know, is basically a criminal. He dies at the end. And Sharon Stone also, he becomes basically collaborating with him.
Mm-hmm.
They both die at the end
yeah.
in the original story. You know, and they changed all that.
And they let him off the hook.
They actually have a happy ending at the end on a nasty story where you should be, these people should be in jail.
It should be a nasty ending.
Exactly.
And then the intersection with Mark Rydell again. But Maverick, now you're talking about another period piece going back to the 1860s and 18.
That's back to the Western, basically.
With Mel Gibson again.
I was relying pretty much on my Western experience, and shot it like a Western. And
it looked like it was fun to do.
But it's a comedy Western, and it was fun to do, And they gave me a role also. I'm actually playing a painter in that movie.
I'll have to look at it again.
I have a smock, and you probably won't recognize me in a painter's hat. And I'm painting a picture, I'm painting a waterfall into a scenery where there's no waterfall. And there's a Russian duke is asking me that, why you put that waterfall into the scenery there? And then I say, like I was a cameraman, I say, I want to make the nature look better than it is. I thought, that cinematographers will love that line,
It's terrific. Make nature better than it is. The Crossing Guard with Sean Penn. Now that must have been
Sean Penn and Jack Nicholson again. Mm-hmm. Jack Nicholson was starring in that, and
but Sean directed it, so he's starting to make himself.
Sean directed it, and then it was so enjoyable to work with Jack again. And Jack, showed me how much he knows about lighting.
Really?
It was really interesting, to find out, that I put a light through a rear window of a trailer, and I didn't tell him that he has to hit that light. I just had a rehearsal. He comes into the trailer, he sits in the spot, and the backlight is hitting his head at the right place. And I didn't tell him that, because I don't like to tell actors, to sit exactly where they should sit. I don't want to give them marks. But Jack comes in, we do 25 takes, and he sits exactly into the same spot, and exactly moves in the light. And then I say, and then he comes at the end, and we say, okay, it's a wrap. He comes to me and says, Vilmos, did I hit your light? I said, what light? You didn't know that I put the light. I said, who do you think I am? You don't think that I see that when you put those lights that I have to hit those? And Jack was funny.
The Assassins with Richard Donner.
With Richard Donner. That was my second picture with him. It was...
He puts up a big movie, always big movie.
Yeah, it's fun to work with Richard because he's a fun guy. He likes to have fun on the set.
Mm-hmm. And then just recently, The Ghost in the Darkness, which got a lot of reviews for the terrific acting and with the terrific lighting and the terrific story fighting the lions in Africa. You had to go to Africa for that.
Yeah, we went to South Africa, and it was a pretty difficult picture, but we had gorgeous scenery. The skies were incredible. They had clouds I'd never seen in my life all day long, every day. And of course, we had some storms occasionally, floods. The floods actually took away our bridge, and we had a lot of problems in that movie.
Vilmos, your filmography is fantastic. You've done so much. You've come so far. And as I said, we're going to come back and talk to you more about this, but for today, any comments to tell us? I mean, it must have been a lot of fun for you.
Well, about this
the
talking?
Whole group. Not just the talking, your film work.
Also my film work. I think I should consider myself very lucky, to be in this field of business, because it's not really business, entertainment, actually. It's really, I'm enjoying my work. And I think all cinematographers enjoy their work. That's why we can keep working on, we never feel tired. Even if you feel tired, you get involved with each shot, each lighting. So at the end of the day, when they say rap, many times, you just feel how tired you are, and you didn't know it 5 minutes before. But it's such a nice way to make a living and be part of an artistic experience, actually.
That's wonderful. Well, until part two, thank you so much for your time for the Heritage series of Vilmos. This has been a terrific interview, and anyone who sees this, I'm sure, will learn a lot. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I understand, in Poland, they would like to have this interview.
I'm sure that we can get it to them.
Because they will give me the Life Achievement Award this year there.
Good.
And they would like to show this there, I think.
I'm sure. sure we'll take care of it. Thank you. We'll fade out and see you in the movies.
All right.
Very good.
Well, at the moment, there is no time frame, actually. When you want to do it as soon as...